A very good morning to all the students of class 12 political science. And students, we were doing the fifth chapter of your book, that is Contemporary World Politics, and the name of the chapter is United Nations and its Organization. As I told you, the biggest name in the NCERT book is the International Organization, but here the name would be United Nations and its Organizations. And we had already started with the chapter in the last video. Today we will be taking the second part of this chapter. So let's see what all we had studied till now as the introduction part to United Nations and its Organization. And most commonly we call it UN. Okay. So the very first question which we have taken up is, why international organizations? We saw various reasons that why at the international platform we require a body which is called United Nations. So there were major reasons for that which we have seen, and some of them I have just written it down for the revision purpose. Otherwise, if you read the first two pages of your NCERT book, you will get around 9 to 10 reasons that why we require an international organization. So first is work in a systematic manner. The very first important thing is, when we talk of the international organizations like United Nations, they work in a very systematic way. Whatever work they are doing in a particular fields, they are being done in a systematic way with the help of various organs and agencies around the world. And the most, if we talk about the objectives also, establish peace. The first and the foremost aim and objective of United Nations, that why it was established, was to establish peace around the world. Because after the First World War, we had established an international body that was League of Nations. So it could not achieve its aim, because again after that also, we had Second World War. So after Second World War, United Nations was established in 1945 on 24th October, so that we may not face the Third World War in future. Of course, there will be some problems and conflicts among the countries when we are living in the same planets, same territories, we are sharing the boundaries. So there will be conflicts, there will be wars, but we have to try to limit those conflicts and try to find a solution to the conflicts by debating and finding solutions peacefully. So for that we needed a platform, and that platform is provided by the United Nations. Also resolve disputes, that is why I have written. Then coordination, cooperation to create better living conditions. As a human being, if we have to make a better living conditions for humans on this earth, because with every passing time, with almost increasing the technologies and the scientific inventions, I would say, the world has become a difficult place to live. So United Nations tries to create a better living place for the humans, and this is only possible when there is coordination and cooperation among the members of the UN. They come up on the same platform, they discuss the various issues, and they try to resolve that conflicts or the tensions between the member countries or the global issues also. That is why I am just explaining global issues, because there are some issues which cannot be handled one-handedly or by one country or two countries, where we require a lot of members to come together to find a solution. So all have to show their initiatives in particular fields. For example, when we talk of epidemics, for example, we are talking about the pandemic of coronavirus. So we require a cooperation and coordination with each other, because that is a global issue. Like global warming, terrorism, these are the issues which are global in nature. Only a single country cannot handle these problems. So we require the United Nations as an international organization. Then, so these are just the few basic points I have written down to the answer that why international organization is required. When we are saying international organization, it means in this book we are talking only about United Nations. So these are some of the revision part I have taken. The topic for the today will be evolution of UN. Evolution of UN. Evolution means, I have written here, a gradual process of change and development. When something changes with passing time and we make various modifications and developments in a particular organization or anything we are talking. Evolution can be of a human being also. Okay. So when we talk about the process of change and development of something, that is called evolution. So we are talking about the evolution of UN here. That how UN was established, and with passage of time after 1945 till date, what are the evolution and what are the changes in its structure, process and jurisdiction. That is the concept we will be discussing today. So that will be the matter and the content of this video lecture. We will be talking about how UN was established, okay, what were the objectives of UN, important objectives of UN for which it was established. We will discuss the organs of the UN, although there are six important important organs of the UN, but in your NCERT book we will be discussing only two organs, that is General Assembly and the Security Council of Union, United Nations. So we will be discussing two organs in your syllabus. Then we will see the organization's structure and process. What is the structure and process of United Nations? And at the last we will talk about the jurisdiction of the organization. So this is going to be the content which we will discuss today. I hope you have understood that why we require United Nations. So now we will be discussing about the evolution of the United Nations in today's lecture, which I will be teaching you from my notes and also from the NCERT book. Okay.
So evolution of the UN. So evolution here means a gradual process of change and development of something. When we talk about the change and development or growth or modifications, we can say of something, that is called evolution. So we are talking about the growth, development and modifications of the United Nations with passage of time. So let's see from the very beginning how it got into establishment. So after the First World War, this is the date which I had already told you in the first chapter, 1914 to 1918. This is a date for the First World War. After the First World War, there was establishment of an international organization whose name was League of Nations, which was established so that they may stop the Second World War, so that there was no other world war between the countries. But it could not fulfill its aim, and Second World War again took place in 1939 to 1945. This is a date for the Second World War, you know that very well. But in this war, Second World War, if we compare it with the First World War, more number of people died, more wounded, there were more destruction economically, socially, and the war than ever before. And finally, the UN was founded. So after the Second World War, the establishment of UN was done, and it was founded as a successor of the League of Nations. Successor means after League of Nations, UN was established. Its aims and objectives were also the same, that there may not be another world war, that is World War III anyhow. So the basic objectives, if we say in short, were to maintain peace among the various countries of the world, so that there may not be a third world war. So let's talk about the UN now, how it got us to establishment. So the UN was established on 24th October, you have to remember, 1945, by signing of the UN Charter of 51 states. So you have to remember date on 24th October 1945 it was established. And how many countries had signed the UN Charter? That is an agreement where all the members, 51 members, agreed that they will be the member of United Nations. So that's called United Charter. So 51 states had signed. But India, if you talk about India, so you should remember many times in the one mark they can ask about India. When did India sign the UN Charter? So India signed the charter on 30th October, same year, 1945. But this was signed on 24th October. India signed the charter after 6 days, that is 30th October. So please remember this gap of 6 days only. Now, at present, UN have 193 members. As present we are talking, the total membership of UN is 193 members, although it was just signed by 51 members in the beginning, but today it is 193 members, which were 192 member states till 2006. There were total 192 members till 2006, but one more country joined United Nations in 2011, and that is South Sudan, an African country. All members have one vote each. If you talk about the voting, all the members have one vote each. If you talk about the General Assembly. Now, the objectives. What are the objectives? Although we have discussed in the introduction part also, but quickly we'll see. To prevent, the first and the most important objectives are to prevent international conflict, because this was the reason that UN was established, so that there may not be any other global war. So if you talk about to stop the international conflicts, as we have seen in the case of invasion of Kuwait by Iraq, we have seen in the second chapter where we saw that there was an invasion of Kuwait by Iraq. Iraq had invaded Kuwait. Now Iraq was told clearly by the UN to liberate the control over the Kuwait and to give freedom to Kuwait. But Iraq did not listen to them. So that series of diplomatic attempts failed to convince Iraq. So lot of diplomatic attempts were made by UN to convince Iraq to free Kuwait, but Kuwait did not listen to anyone. So finally, UN played an Operation Desert Storm by UN. This was the operation put forward by the UN, and in which US we saw the maximum of the troops over of US. Okay, So this is an example where we can see that UN has taken initiatives to stop the problems or the international conflict so that there may not be a third. So UN will always interfere whenever there are situations like this where the powerful country tries to suppress the other one, like we saw in the case of Operation Desert Storm. This also I have discussed, to show cooperation among the states. Okay, of course, this organization, there is a very much need that they must cooperate and show coordination with each other to find the solution to the various global issues, to work in social economic development in the world. Of course, other than the main objective, that is to maintain peace and decorum around the world, also they have to look forward to the various developments of in the field of social economic developments to help the epidemics and any crisis in the world. If there are any crises at the world level globally, when we talk about the global issues like terrorism or the global warming, so there will be always a coordination and the cooperation among the states. These are the objectives. So now let's see the main organs of the United Nations. United Nations is a body, that is an international body, but alone it cannot work. It cannot work alone. So there are various organs working in the different fields who have different functions and roles. So United Nations has 6 organs, but we will focus only on the 2 important organs of UN in your NCERT book. So in this syllabus, we will be talking about the only 2 organs. And those 2 important organs of the United Nations are General Assembly and Security Council. So if you talk about the General Assembly is an assembly where all the members who have signed the charter, as we have seen, there are 193 members till 2011. So presently there are 193 members. So all these 193 members will be a part of General Assembly, and they will also have a right to vote. That is one vote. Every member will have a one vote, every country. But if you talk about the Security Council, this is another important organ of the United Nations. In this, the structure is like that. There are some permanent members, some are non-permanent members. These 5 are the permanent members, and others are the non-permanent member, 10 members. Okay, so you have to understand who all the countries have signed the UN Charter. They are the member of General Assembly, and these are the organs within the United Nations. These are not the separate organs. These are the part of United Nations only. In the General Assembly, all the countries are the member. But if you talk about this organ of the United Nations, Security Council, there are 5 permanent members and 10 non-permanent members. So permanent means they cannot be removed. They will be permanent anyhow. So US, Russia, China, UK and France, these are the countries who are permanent. And the reason, because when United Nations was established after the Second World War, these were the countries who were the most powerful. In fact, these were the victorious countries on the Second World War. So they became the permanent members. Okay, and each of these countries have veto power. They enjoy the veto power. It means they have the negative vote. And if you talk about the non-permanent members, there are total 10 members. And they change after every 2 years. The members, they keep changing after 2 years. It means the tenure of the non-permanent members in the Security Council is only for 2 years. But these 5 are permanent and they have the veto power. And I hope you all of you have read in detail veto power in the junior classes. Because since class 6th, 7th, you have been studying what do we understand by veto power. These 5 members have this veto power, where all the countries taking a decision. But if any country out of these do not like the decision, they can go against the bill, and that decision will not be accepted because one of the permanent member is against that bill. So this is called veto power. Now, Secretary General, like we have the Prime Minister, President, so the head of the United Nations is called Secretary General. He is the head of the UN, and presently Antonio Guterres is the Secretary General or the head of the UN, and he from 1st January 2007, and he's from Portugal. He was also the Prime Minister of Portugal. So you have to remember, in the 1 mark question, this question can be there. Now, UN consists of many different structures and agencies. As I told you, UN as a body cannot work on its own. It requires various structures and agencies and organs, like I have told about General Assembly and Security Council, and they all have different functions, various roles to play. Like General Assembly will discuss some other functions, alag conflicts or matters. Security Council has some other functions. In the same way, there are various agencies which have different work. Okay, war and peace and difference between member states are discussed. Whatever, if there are conflict tensions between the members of the United Nations, that is being discussed in the General Assembly as well in the Security Councils. So any problems relating to war and peace or differences and conflicts and tension between the member states, those all matter are discussed in the General Assembly as well as in the Security Council, so that we can find a peaceful solution to the conflicts. So these territorial disputes or water relating dispute do not escalate into a war, a physical war. So social economic issues are dealt with by many. If we talk about social and economic issues, if it is relating to conflicts, war and peace, the problem is solved in the General Assembly or the Security Council. But if we talk about the social and economic issues or development, it is dealt by the various agencies. Various agencies have been established to work out for a particular field, like World Health Organization, UNDP, UNHRC, Human Resource, UN, UNICEF, etc., UNESCO, WHO, ILO. Okay, so all these organizations are like the agencies of United Nations who are performing their duties for United Nations, so that the work of United Nations can be worked out smoothly. Because alone a single organization cannot work. It needs various organs and agencies to work in coordination. Now our topic is reforms of UN. When we are talking about the reforms, okay, so reforms or evolutions we are talking. So what were the changes? Reforms mean changes or modifications. What are the changes and modifications we can see in United Nations after the Cold War? That is after 1991, what are the changes? Because this United Nations was established in 1945. So from 1945 till 1991, if you talk about the political, social and economic circumstances at the world level, it has changed dramatically. So because previously, after the Second World War, there was a Cold War where there were two superpowers and their alliances. But after 1991, there was single superpower, that is United Nations, US, United States and USSR had disintegrated. So we'll see what are the changes after the disintegration of USSR or after the end of Cold War. So in the introduction part, it's written, reforms and improvements or developments are fundamental to any organization. If we have organization, we will continuously need to reform, make changes and improvements in that particular organizations with the demand of time and change in time and circumstances. Okay, so that we can serve the need of the changing environment. So if we have to serve and move with the time ahead, we need to make various reforms and changes and developments in the organizations. So same was done with the United Nations, as United Nations is no exception. As in recent year, there has been demand for reforms or the world body. So in the recent year, if we say, there has been lot of demands around the world where people are on the member countries are asking for reforms of United Nations. So let's see what are the demands of the member countries, which type of reforms they want. So basically, two basic kinds of reforms face the UN. So we are talking about the two kinds of reforms. One is organization, that is UN's structure and process. We want some changes in the structure and process of the UN. Like we saw just now, there are six organs and one is General Assembly, Security Council. Under Security Council, there are permanent members, that is 5 in number, non-permanent member, 10 in member. They have a tenure of 2 years. All this comes under structure and process. So some of the members want to change, make reforms to this system, and also some reforms are required in the jurisdiction of the organization. Jurisdiction means legal powers or authority. To the range, we see the range of authorities. What are the areas where UN can work out its powers? That is called jurisdiction. Kiti daira bolte hain Hindi mein, like na, kiti dur tak daira hai. So we talk about the jurisdiction of organization also. So first of all, talk about reforms of the organization's structure and process. So what is the demand of the people, opinion of the people? So the biggest discussion has been, so in this field of change or the reforms in the structure and process, the biggest discussion has been on the functioning of the Security Council. People are not happy with the Security Council and the structure of the Security Council, and it has not changed after it was established. Because as we are saying, with change in time, we need to change something to move ahead in time. But Security Council has not changed this process and structure and demand for increase, because the member countries are demanding that there should be an increase in the United Nations Security Council's permanent and non-permanent memberships. As you know, there are 193 members now till 2011. Okay, out of these 193, 5 are permanent, 10 are non-permanent. It means only 15 countries are the member of Security Council, United Nations Security Council, which is an organ, one of the important organ of United Nations, and only 15 members are there in out of 193. So they think that these 50 members do not reflect the real contemporary politics of the world at the current scenario. So they demand to increase these permanent and non-permanent members. Increase in the members membership so that the realities of contemporary world politics are better reflected, so that the current contemporary world politics reality are reflected. If there will be an increase in the number of membership on the permanent and non-permanent members, okay. And they also want that there should be a representation given to the continents like Asia, Africa and Latin America also. So they want that continental wise we should be given representation in the Security Council, United Nations Security Councils. Now, review of the issues that fall. Now, if you talk about the other reforms, jurisdiction of the organization. So, in the field of jurisdiction of the organization, review of the issues that fall within the jurisdiction of the organization. So, what are the matters will fall under the jurisdiction of the United Nations? So, some countries and experts want organization to work and play a greater role, more effective role in peace and security. So, some people, some countries, they want that United Nations should only focus to maintain peace and security around the world. They should only work to look after the peace and security around the world between the various countries. While the others and the other countries feel that United Nations should also work for development and humanitarian. Okay, development growth, it means in the field of, it should work for health, education, environment, population control, human rights, gender, social justice. And yes, this is true that now United Nations is not only about maintaining peace and decorum around the world or solving the conflicts between the various countries, but it is also working working very closely to improve the health, education and environmental and population control, population control, human rights, gender. These are the some of the important fields and many more where United Nations is actively participating and trying to improve the problems of the people and making this earth a better place for human beings. Now let's see exactly what were the changes. We have seen the evolutions after the Cold War, what were the changes required. But now exactly we'll see what type of changes we find after the Cold War. First, World War II was 1939 to 1945, end of Cold War, that is 1945 to 1991. I hope you can understand these dates. In first chapter we have discussed in detail. So the first change we see was the UN was established in 1945, immediately after the Second World War. The way it was organized and the way it functioned reflected the realities of the world politics in the after the Second World War. After the Cold War, these realities are different. Here are some of the changes that occur. So they are saying after the Second World War, this United Nations was established. So that reflected the realities of the world politics at that time, after the Second World War. But now after 1991, after the Cold War or after the disintegration of USSR, the realities of the world or the contemporary political realities have changed. Okay, let's see what are the changes at the world level if we see after the disintegration of USSR. So USSR Union had collapsed in 1991, it disintegrated. When it disintegrated, US became the, we could say, hegemon power or the most supreme power, strongest power, or the world was a single pole now. The relationship between Russia and the successor of the Soviet Union and the US is much cooperative. Now if we talk about the relationship between Russia, who is the successor of Soviet Union, after the disintegration of Soviet Union, all the agreements which were pending were accepted by Russia. Even the membership in the United Nations Security Council was given to Russia. So now they have a better cooperative and understanding and relation with US. China, as we have seen in the chapter, new centers of power. China is now, if we talk about the realities of political realities, economic realities of the modern time, China is emerging as a great power. India is also growing rapidly. We have discussed that. Even the countries of Asia, we have seen Southeast Asian nation, ASEAN, we have studied. okay, and we have talked about SAARC also. So we can talk about Asian countries. They are growing at an unprecedented rate. So at the moment, they are in the phases of developing. Many new countries have joined the UN after collapse of USSR. So after 1991, some countries have joined UN. The whole new set of challenge confronts the world. Now there are completely different challenges. If we talked about the challenges and the aims and objectives of United Nations after the World War II, that is 1945, those concepts were different, those problems were different. But if we talk about after 1991, the problems which has come up are totally different. If you talk about chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, or chapter 4, which you have studied, till you have studied, you will find the problems of genocide, that is killing of people in a large number belonging to a particular religion, caste, language, or a social group. Okay, these problems, civil wars within the countries, there are various sections, you will see a conflict between them, ethnic conflicts based on the culture or caste. Terrorism is the problem, nuclear proliferation, where information and technology and material relating to nuclear is being shared with other countries. Climate change is a major problem. We talk of the global warming, air pollution, water pollution, environmental degradation like deforestation, epidemics and many other diseases. And recently we are facing coronavirus. So these are the new challenges, and to tackle with the new challenges, United Nations need to make certain modifications and changes and reforms in its structure and process and jurisdictions also. So it is required. So they are trying to prove here that previously till 1945, the circumstances were different, and to tackle with those problems, UN was ready. But now we need to make certain changes because there are complete new set of challenges which the world is facing now. As the Cold War was ending by 1919 onwards, question facing the world was. So as the Cold War was ending around 1989 or 1991 onwards, there was a question which the world was facing. Is the UN doing enough? What reforms are necessary to make the world work better? So in the next part, we'll talk more about the evolutions or the reforms in the structures and process. Because here we have seen why it was required. Because there were completely new set of challenges coming up. Okay. So here I will end the video now. Thank you so much.